Just show of hands very quickly, who in the audience is an architect or aspiring to be an architect? Okay? Who in the audience is a musician? Who in the audience is a marathon runner? Who is all three of these things combined? And would you imagine that we actually found two of these people to put them back to back? So something that Michel does, and both of the characters we have for you tonight are all three, and they're coming here to Toronto to run the marathon, and we thought, hey, you're going to be here. We need to have you come and talk about all the things that you do. And one of the things that Michel did, being a musician amongst other things, he said, you know what? Every time there's a concert, the musicians will bring on stage some of the new and aspiring and energetic musicians to kind of be a bit of an opening act. So I'll agree to do this, but I want to have my buddy Chris Köhn come and join me on stage. Perfect. So first thing I get to do is introduce Chris. And Chris will come and speak a few minutes, and then we'll have Michel join as well. But Chris, if you're already not intrigued by the fact that he's all these three things combined and a bit more, he also loves to cook and do all these other kinds of things, was telling me that this passion goes back to being 10 years old and his parents building their house, and here's him on the side drawing up his own version of drawings and plans. So you could see that from very early age, he was already messing with the world and trying to make things happen in his own way. So definitely breaking down the barriers and being creative on all fronts, we get to hear what Chris is doing these days. So come on, please.
Hobbies are not hobbies. Actually, the spatial should no longer be approached only by architects, but rather by many disciplines in order to have a full experiential design. I'm an architect, I'm a musician, I'm a runner, I'm a cook, and I'm a movie buff. All of these are correlated: architecture, music, cooking, running, cinema, and they all work as tools, and I use them as tools for design. Although I really love designing, the main idea is that these hobbies are complemented and everyday passions can be used in design. So what do these hobbies have in common? They all work with rhythm. It's a medium working with the beat. I was in a couple of months, but as you can see, it has a visual rhythm. Run has a rhythm, a pace, cooking has a pace, and everything flowing. As you can see, to me, emotions of pain. What else do they have in common? They all work with the ma. The ma space is a Japanese concept, a filter, a transition between one space entering another. This kind of a negative space which takes place in the imagination of the user. And it's a more of a conscious place, and it can't be built. This ma space is a transition while you enter from an exterior to an interior. And you have to get this kind of a psychological and imaginative place from one transition to another. And this concept, although it's a very spatial concept, I think it can be applied also to the music. Brian Eno talks a lot about it while composing. The most difficult thing is to remove notes and to create silences. And this goes for architecture as well. Creating silences is, I think, it's the most difficult thing. And in food, it can be applied as well. If you have a nice drinker's meal, the relationship between each dish, the change from one hot meal to a sour meal, the lemon sherbet with basil connecting one to another is the real tiny space that keeps things flowing. While running, although at some moments you're floating in space, you get to be connected, your legs, your hips, your thighs, although they're not touching the ground, you're all connected, and you have this tiny experiential place which connects and makes everything flow. These hobbies also work with time. Richard Miller, a physicist, published recently a book talking about creating a new space that will create new time. And although it's a scientific approach, I would consider my architecture and the projects I'm interested in to contemplate and to create the perception of time. So this is a project I will be talking about in a couple of minutes. And it's very simple, yet all the walls and all the ceilings are working on perceiving the time. Memory. All these hobbies also work with a memory. You could always remember the first time you were at your parents' house, and when you got back 20 years after, the memory you had about a place was probably much bigger, and the space itself was differently, and in your memory was conceived in another way. In music, if you surely remember the first time you listened to a Leonard Cohen song. I'm a huge fan, by the way, and probably you guys are also, he's from around. And also, this is a Peruvian dish. My wife is Peruvian, and I've learned to cook Peruvian dishes. It's called anticucho de pescado, which is a fish bouchette. And the interesting thing about this dish is that the own dish has its memory of its own. It was conceived a couple of hundred years ago while the slaves didn't have much to eat, so they started eating all the leftovers and eating all the guts. And so this originally is conceived by eating the heart of the beef, which is delicious, by the way. And it's the relationship between the ají panca, which is a red pepper sauce, and the vinegar and the pepper. It's all connected, and all the dish creates, although it could take it somewhere if you eat it like while you were young, the dish has the memory of its own. And in architecture and the designs I'm interested in is this approach, to have the architecture create a memory of its own. So all these tools, rhythm, the relationship between space and time, and the memory and the mass space are tools I really interested in while designing. So this is a 8-garden house project. As the name says, it has 8 gardens. The initial layout was a 1,000 square meters construction, and the whole idea as a social responsibility was for me to approach the client and to reduce the impact of the site and to build 30% less than the initial project and to insert nature and gardens into the space. So although it's a public, semi-public, private, and semi-private part, it works with rhythm. We started using an orthogonal grid to be efficiently cost-wise, and by inserting the gardens and playing around with the walls was how we achieved the real sequence between the house. But the real rhythm I'm interested in is this transition from disconnecting from one place to another, this mass space I was talking about. So this house is located in outside Mexico City, about an hour far away. That contrast between this chaotic metropolitan city, which I love, by the way, into a nature atmospheric home. This transition was made through these sunlights and shadows play that create this filter to really disconnect from the metropolitan environment into a natural environment. So this is kind of what it looks like. This was a shooting for Louis Vuitton at the house for a fashion magazine, but you could see the rhythm on the ceiling creating this game of lights and shadows. And this, my experience, this almost as a four-dimensional place of light and shadows evolving and moving through the walls, through the ceilings, to the floor. And also transitioning from one public space on the left to one private space on the right that compresses you and gets you through a long corridor into the master bedroom, which be the most private part of the area. Inserting music into the project, although the project has a sound system that can be controlled through your mobile device and to have different scenarios, the real soundscape I was interested in was to incorporate all the natural sounds and the wind flowing through the branches of the different patios and the sounds of the birds into the architecture. So cooking, we as Latins have this cultural of having the kitchen as the heart of the house. The gathering of the families takes place always at the kitchen. And this idea was conceived into the space. So we have this memory of the, let's say, the Latin heart into the space. So the main garden was the garden of the kitchen. And the whole idea was to conceive a relationship between nature and cooking. So we did this orchard with potatoes and vegetables and fruits, so you can have this consciousness of relationship between getting and conceiving food. This, according to The Guardian, this is the second best dish in the world. It's a ceviche, a Peruvian ceviche in a this guy is called Chess Wong. He is about 93 years old, and he has a very nice, very simple restaurant, four tables in a poor neighborhood in Lima. But the main concept I'm interested in was that he shares his cooking, his heart, and you could see while eating on these four tables his process, and sharing no secrets. He's all open and with his heart open to share all of his knowledge into the people he doesn't know. So this idea was to connect the kitchen with the dining room. The kitchen is on the right and the dining room on the left. And this is the view of the from the kitchen. You have this principal water garden. We also wanted to reduce the impact, the social and environmental impact of the project, so we inserted this water garden, avoiding the use of air conditioning. And through this wind flowing, the kitchen refreshes while cooking, and you have this amazing view. Also, we have this tabachin. It's a tree called, it's a very local tree, and that was also the representation of the heart and the water. And running, although we have a treadmill and a small fitness center of the project, the real concept of running I was interested in was to capture all these beautiful moments while you get to see while running on the sunset, on the sunrise, on the beach, on the snow, on the mountains, the lights of the coming to the woods, or the colorful branches on trees in autumn. So we started developing with this landscape firm to have different scenarios, different colors, all with local and natural plants of the region. And we ended up inserting all these beautiful scenarios you get to see while running into the different gardens. So you get to see this main garden, the cycads garden on the center. On the left, these pictures were taken, by the way, at the end of the project, so it wasn't spring and they were all green with no so much colors. But the whole idea was to is and has different scenarios. You have the Makuli garden on the right above, which turns into a beautiful white blossom tree. The Bougainvillea garden, which is for the master bedroom, that now looks very, very purple. And you have also the orchard and the tabachin, which is also a beautiful orange color. And at last, the cinema. Although we have a home, nice home theater with surround sound, the real concept I was interested in was the time and space changes, how to capture how light changes through the project. So we developed with a landscape lighting design, different scenarios for the gardens, and to conceive how light changes from a sunset to a sunrise, and the contrast between the warmth of the lighting on the interior of the house with the exterior. So as Stanley Kubrick says, to really capture this progression of moods and feelings into the space, and to create this emotion. So we have this contrast between very warm light and this blue sky spaces that really get you conscious of the architecture of the house. And at the end, all of these tools helped create a memory. A couple of months ago, I was having dinner with a client. She's the director of the Contemporary Museum in Mexico City, the MUAC. And she was telling me how happy she was with the project, and that she really felt that the project and the architecture was so silent that it could conceive all nature. And she told me and invited me to stay there and really live the full experience of the house. So at the end, all of these tools, these passions, these everyday hobbies you have, and my point would be to get to feel them and to apply them into your designs. It's not only having studied architecture that makes you an architect, but having your eyes wide open for everything you love and to insert all this passion into the designs. That would be all.
Perfect. We'll ask Chris to join Michel at the end, and we'll have a question and answer period at that time.
Perfect.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you.
So now I get to introduce Michel Rojkind. And really, what can I say? I could talk about, you know, how he played in front of stadiums with 50,000 people. I can tell you about, you know, projects he's done all over the world, you know, showing up in Dubai and having fans outside of the airport shouting, but I want to just leave you with one little story that does have a point to it. And we were both in architecture school in Mexico City, and one day I show up and I have a model, and at that time there was no 3D printing or anything like that, but I didn't use cardboard, I didn't use paper, I didn't use anything for that, I used clay. So this was a model all made out of mud. And of course, in order to keep the clay dry, I have to keep bags on top of it. And in any case, so I put it on the table and everybody's there and I pull it off. And of course, everybody then sees it's mud and they're worried about their clothes. And unanimously, everybody just takes a step back, right? And the only person who took a step forward and actually got his hands in there was Michel. So I want to introduce Michel as the one person who steps forward when everybody else steps back. Come on up.
Thank you, Tonio. Okay, thanks. Thanks for having us over on such a quick notice. Yes, we're here to run the marathon. We're excited, thrilled. Thanks, Chris, for presenting. Thanks for receiving, Chris. I think it's important that you get to know other architects that are up and coming and doing great work. And I think that Chris's work will get, you'll get good news from Chris in the future, as you heard a little bit of his projects now. I'm going to talk a little bit about shared responsibility, because with time, I've been trying to understand, what do we do? And who do we work for? And what's the role that everybody's playing when we work for somebody? You know, so much energy invested, so much money invested, so much time invested. And talking about shared responsibility and coming from Mexico, when you see Mexico City, as I always say, our small town of 22 million people, And I say, building in Mexico? I said, really? But what Mexico are we building? A Mexico that's divided? A Mexico of traditions? A Mexico of bad planning? Super bad planning. No, we keep on growing outside. A Mexico that has, I think, the worst government that we've ever had. This is our Zócalo, which is our main public plaza. And this was when Peña Nieto was giving his public speech, one of his first speeches, and all the politicians took the plaza. So they put the cars inside, all the bodyguards were there. They didn't let anybody walk inside, no? So that's a little bit of what the government started reflecting. A Mexico that now has more protests, and I say peaceful protests, because I take my 11-year-old daughter, and I think that if I was taken at 11 years old to a protest of wanting to do some changes in Mexico, I think we would have a different country. So I'm happy to take my daughter there, and I think it's important that we're there, because what will change our future is seeing all of the other Mexicans that are also marching and are against what's happening now. Even though the government says these are riots and they're the vandalism and, of course, the things that we always get in the news. We're surprised that our president is featured in all these magazines. We were more surprised to have him invite Donald Trump. I think that's when you think it couldn't get worse, it gets worse, no? Even Hillary was rejecting flying over. He says, I'm not going to Mexico City. She says, instead of inviting the candidates, why don't you worry about the disappeared students? 2 years up to today, and we're still missing the disappeared students. I can keep on going. We were surprised to have him at the, I remember when he was elected president, you had this saying, oh, saving Mexico. Finally, we're going to have this president that's going to save Mexico City. And a couple of weeks later, not months or years, a couple of weeks later, you had this one on the internet, which I think makes sense more now of all the dead people that we have. We have a sort of amnesia because we forget that most of our presidents have been featured in Time magazine, which is, no, something that we're not too proud of. But I'm not here. We all have our share of political things happening, so I'm not here to talk about the bad things of politics. I'll try to make up the good things. This guy, MacGyver, and also shows a little bit my age, because when I show this in new architecture schools, they say, who is this guy? They don't know who this guy is. I hear a couple of you might know who MacGyver is, but he could fix everything with his Swiss army knife, no? And I say this could be patented as made in Mexico, because in Mexico, you have these guys that work miracles. This is a wonderful image, guys. This is not set up, and I promise. I was so jealous not to have planned this picture, but this, I was passing by, and I'll explain to you, because this is how Mexico works. This guy here, he's the owner of the store here. So the stoplight didn't work. So nobody was stopping in his store because people were crashing or either passing super quick at that corner, and nothing, and he was losing money. His business wasn't working. He called, of course, the municipality. Nobody came. The police didn't come. Nobody sent anybody to fix the electric thing on the light. So he called his compadre, who had the truck. He pulls the truck over. He takes the ladder up. And this guy, even though he's not an electrician, he's trying to fix the stop sign. Once that's happening, of course, then you get the police guy. He shows up like, yeah, we're taking over. Yes, this is under control. The government is here. And this actually is a reflection of Mexico. In Mexico, we have to be creative because of necessity. It's a different, it's being, ¿cómo se dice ingenio? Ingenious by necessity, not because we want to be creative. We have to, the system is not working, and we have to figure out a way to work around it. But once you try to work around it, then the government suddenly appears. They want to have the gold medal in their chest, no? Saying, yeah, we thought of this first. So this is a reflection of Mexico. When we say Occupy, when I was hearing Occupy Wall Street, because obviously in America, people are super good at branding. In Mexico, we're a little bit delayed on the branding part. I say Occupy also should have been a Mexican word, no? Because in Mexico, we really occupy, no? So when you find a guy that's putting his stuff in his car and just sits there and reads his newspaper or whatever, we're occupying, you know? We occupy a newspaper stand to watch concerts. And if you look up in Google, Mexican creativity, you find all these crazy things, no? Funny because it's always like in a verge of collapsing, but it's always really ingenious. But I'll talk more about rebuilding. And when I talk about rebuilding, and as architects, I think we were spoon-fed context. And I remember, you have to think of the context all the time. We were fed context. And I would, at the beginning, I didn't even understand what context was. I started understanding. And then I said, well, wait a minute. I think context should be a selection of things. It shouldn't be literally a context. And I'll explain this better. When I was partners with Isaac Broid and Miquel Adria, Isaac Broid is the generation of Enrique Norton and Alberto Calach, and I thought I was super happy to join them because they were an older generation. I was going to learn so much. And here was Isaac doing a building, contextualizing in Condesa era in Mexico City. He had, of course, seeing the building next to it with the windows, everything kind of aligned perfect to an old building next to his. By the time he finished his building, somebody bought the building next to it, demolished the building, and did something else. So I was saying, what context? You were contextualizing with something that now doesn't exist, no? So I mean, if we're in a historical district, of course, the context is super important. In other parts, what is the context? Is it political? Is it social? Is it economical? So all these selections of things make the context, and that's why we produce architecture, or how we produce architecture. When we talk about materiality, I normally talk about digital design, but digital design in a way that it's a tool. It doesn't solve your life, it doesn't solve a problem, it solves problems for sure. But what about the craft? What about the place we're working at? What's the local fabrication? How can I benefit and how can I do this crossover between the digital realm and the craftsmanship and what has been there for ages? How can we learn from each other? When I talk about space today, I talk about versatility. How can it be flexible enough to adapt to a society that's constantly changing? And finally, the program. We're a bit stubborn at the office, and I mean it in a good way. We try to question the client's original idea. And we ask them first, what is the added value of your program? Are you just doing another typical building or generic building? Is it really connecting? Does it add something to the public realm or to the city? Or is it just going to be a standalone project? So I'm going to start with the context and talk about Liverpool. This is a department store. Normally, as an architect, we all want museums and cultural programs, and you want to do all this cool stuff. But sometimes you get other clients. You get a department store, and you have to figure out if you want to do it first or you want to work with the client. And I've been lucky enough to be able to get interesting clients that want to push a little bit of their ideas. And we thought it was interesting to work something with a department store in a way to give back, question again the program. So this sits in Interlomas. Interlomas is a suburb inside a suburb. I always mention it like inception-wise, that the deeper you get in the mind of these cities, within a city, the less people you see walking, the less public spaces you have. So all these suburbs are kind of these lost areas that keep on growing in Mexico, unfortunately, but there is a lack of public space. So the first thing that we questioned on this project is, by doing a department store, can we add a public space, even though it's in a private building? Can we do something that's kind of this mix, or that, again, with the guy trying to fix the cables on a stop sign, can we provide something in a public building that kind of works a little bit for the society around it? And here we, a small video, we convinced the company, because at the beginning they had only hired us to do
maybe we just like being afraid.
The facade of the building, they said, oh, we have this building.
We're just so used to it at this point that it's just a part of us.
They said, well, wait a minute,
part of our culture.
Architects and we design spaces.
Security alert on orange.
We don't do
it's been on orange since 01, G. I mean, what's up, man? Can a brother get yellow, man?
So let us try to
just for like 2 months or something.
Meaningful than just the facade of the building. And we worked on the facade, of course.
My check.
Which sits on
the groove is thick, so I'm a rhyme like a lunatic. I do this shit with an unassuming wit. The corporation conjured up is based in the tempo. My name is Liv, that's the intro, now let's blow. The flow of life, throw on strife. Into the links to the pick.
I won't get into all the details, but actually it's 3,800 different panels. It's the first project that we've ever done that we send a 3D model to a company in Kansas in the United States, Zahner Metals. And out of the 3D model, they fabricated everything and shipped it to Mexico. But after doing the facade that the client wanted, we said, well, okay, we're done with the design of the facade. Can we extend our contract and work the upper part of the building? And the client says, well, what do you propose? And we say, well, let's have this public space, and why don't we work with your company? And we work with the company, and we started doing parts of the programs that they can get on top, because of course, if I wanted to do a public space, what's the program? What's the activation of that space? And they decided to put their gastronomical area on the top of the building. Here, as you can see, this was mostly single family houses. Now these are for sale because they're doing all these super high density developments. So this is what I was saying. It's just sprawling and growing and growing and growing. All these spaces that you see here, they're private spaces. So we got to extend our commission for the project. So we got to do also the skylight and then the staircase to go, the stairs to go up. This is how the project sits on the road, which is actually it was designed to be super high speed because you only can look at it in a passing car. But then we provided the upper space, which at the beginning was 80% park, 20% program. But when they saw it as a economical benefit, they started growing the program, and it grew a little bit bigger. Fortunately, you still have a lot of green area on top. But what that happened is that now this area provides 30% of the income of the store. And then the store extended their hours until 2 a.m. in the morning during the weekends. So we shifted, and again, when I was talking about added value, this started becoming an iconic project, not because of how it looks, but because what it could provide to the community around it. No, so they proposed to leave it open until 2 a.m. The government said yes, it was perfect. So you have a lot of people now dining here and then maybe buying some books or glasses or bottles of wine or whatever. But that's one of the projects. I'll show you another one later in the presentation. Cineteca Nacional was another project that we did working for the government. This was with our previous government. This was with Calderon, and it was kind of his claim to fame cultural project after he left. When you get a phone call by the government 9 months before the government leaves, you start panicking because they said, we have there's a good project that we might want to do with your office. And I said, there's only 9 months left. What are you planning? Maybe something small. And then you hear that it's a 60,000 square meter project, redevelopment of a film institute that already exists. And then you, even though we're super optimistic and we want to imagine that we can do many, many things, we are faced with reality, and we started working on the project as fast as we could. The remodeling of an existing cinema place in Mexico City. And this was the image of the original project. So you had these four boxes that were used, of course the theaters are inside, but this is a whole terrain. So when people would come in, they would arrive, walk through this small path, get in, and that was a public space of the Film Institute. This was designed by Manuel Rocha, the father of Mauricio Rocha, a very talented colleague and Mexican architect as well, a good friend. So when we got there, we were questioning again this identity, and here's the complete floor plan of the National Film Institute. The terrain is amazing, the plot is amazing, and nobody ever knew that it was so big. People would just, as I was saying, would go in here and go in here, and that was their experience of Cineteca. All of this was a car park. So the first thing that we did that we were not asked for was take away the car park, put a parking garage structure here, just leave the cars outside, but as soon as you pass the threshold of the parking lot, then you enter a green campus. We also put forth new cinemas there because there is a second access here in a small town called Joco, that kind of is strangled by the sprawling growth of the city. You have a 26-floor tower here. There's another one that's going to happen around here about 60 stories high. So creating a park in such a dense neighborhood that will eventually change was an amazing opportunity to kind of recover and recapture. So in this part, the neighbor here is in the old town of Joco is a cemetery, which you have these beautiful green trees, and of course this is not going to change. So it kind of connects through a back entrance that used to be a back entrance, and we made it a secondary entrance. So this access, along with the first access, is where the four new cinemas connect to the existing cinemas. And we put a canopy over this area so it could create spaces for other things to happen. These are the vaults, and this is a new vaulted archive that I also asked. Some of the operations, Mauricio Rocha was then invited to work on the project. I think it was a great move by the government opening it up to another architect. And of course, Mauricio, since we're good friends, and also him doing an intervention in his father's piece, He did some new offices. He did a video tech information center here, and then the museum in the back. This is a little bit of the construction images, the canopy that will float on the top of the area, the Museum of Mauricio here in the back. Some of the ideas of the structure, and again, 9 months designed and built before the government left. So it was a bit crazy. We had to design something that, while we were working the structure, we were figuring out the panelization of these light elements that I was thinking, and because I wanted super even light at the bottom, the edges are, they don't have perforations, and as you walk on the inside, the center is more perforated, so the light is more even. And this is how it looked before. These are some of the images after. And here you start seeing the car park here as a structure. It's been 3 years since it's opened, and it's still not finished. Things that happened in Mexico that we're not super proud of. We opened the project, which was the first time I ever did a public project that was not finished, and it opened to public. So again, that's where I started understanding what bullying was, what trolling was about. When you get, when you're being bullied in Twitter and all these media, that they were like, "Oh, look at the architect; he didn't finish this, and this is awful." I was like, "It's not finished. No, they didn't finish the construction of the project." And you still have the gardens that are unfinished. You still have the parking lot that's missing a facade. But what I'm super proud of is that people that go now to the Film Institute made it their own. And you'll see what I mean. Of course, there's no complaint on the inside. Here we worked with Hector Esraue, who did interiors with us. So everything sounds, of course, much, much better, the audio, the acoustics. But I was more concerned on the outside, which were the extra parts that I wanted to deliver. This is the outdoor cinema that once we proposed it, there was some skepticism on the part of the government saying, oh, people are not going to sit down. You should do a concrete amphitheater so people sit on the concrete. And I said, no, because if there's a concrete amphitheater, it cannot be used for anything else. Why don't we leave it as a garden? If there's nothing playing, at least you can use it as additional spaces. This is what happens on a day-to-day basis. This was almost a couple of days after the opening. It was still unfinished. You would still see some details of the roof being put together. The only trees that are here now are the ones that existed on the site that we kind of moved. So we're still missing landscape that I hope we get to, or they get to finish it. As I was saying, the space now was appropriated. When I say occupy, and again, I was saying that if you leave spaces for all these things, you'll see people either having things for tragic events in Mexico where they can get things together to send it to the people in need, people still complaining for the disappeared students, other people complaining about other things or trying to get their message clear, but also good things. You have jazz concerts now that didn't happen. And this is provided because there's a space for those things to happen. You have experimental things going on, theater, you have other things that were not part of the original program. And the Cineteca talks about all the records that they've broken in terms of ticket sales, but I'm still waiting for them to tell us how many people go that don't buy tickets, because I think now it became this public space that does something for the city. No? I mean, people, you could see other things happening. This is a funny story because these are called petates. And even though the government then agreed to do the public space for the outdoor cinema, they said, well, we'll do some petates because then people will sit in the petate instead of sitting on the garden. And once there was a screening, I was behind a young couple, and I heard the guy tell the girlfriend, do you want one petate or two petates? And I said, oh, what's the trick here? No, so I follow them. And the thing is, if you have one petate, you watch the movie. And if you use two petates, you don't watch the movie. You just kiss, no? And or you do a chocorrol, or that would. So you kind of save on the second petate, you just roll over, that's it, or start doing some yoga, acro yoga. But anyway, this was the day of the opening. We were expecting 600 people, there were 3,000 people on the space. You would see people on the gates outside that are now used for exhibitions of the Film Institute. And here I am with Peter Greenaway. This was a great experience, but because they called me up saying, oh, Peter Greenaway is going to be here, and would you be kind enough to give him a tour? I said, are you kidding? I'm going to ask for him. I will ask him for his autograph first, but yes, I'll give him a tour. I'm super fans of Peter Greenaway. So I was there, instead of showing him, I was asking him all these questions about his movies. But after we toured and I asked him, well, what do you think about the space? And he actually said like two things that to me, I still keep now. One was, he was really excited that we didn't enter through a lobby and distribute it to the typical film institutions that you have, that it looks like a shopping center and you're just divided to the different theaters on different areas. He said, I love the idea that in Mexico, with the weather you have, you feel more like a campus and less than like a shopping center. But the second, and we were on the mezzanine, and he looks down and he saw the couple kissing and a guy with his dog and kids running. He says, you created space for the quotidian. You created space so we understand what we will do next. You as an architect, me as a filmmaker, because we watch the quotidian, and here's where we get inspired for things to do. Here's where I create films, here's where a guy writes, here's where an architect designs. So learn and pay attention to what you're doing with these spaces that were not part of the original program. And so that kept with me, and I'll keep on going with that. Tori Tori, which is a small restaurant that we did, because we don't specialize in any particular theme. I was coming from a musical background, coming from this idea where you don't want to be pinned. You don't want to be tagged as, oh, what type of music do you play? What type of architecture do you do? Do you specialize in housing? We did this, it was a house reconversion, old project, but I want to show again the craft that I talk about when I say digital design, but local fabrication. I understood the craft, and I understand the craft in Mexico, that when I was studying in Mexico, I used to complain, as we all do most of the times when we're in our countries or our cities, that we say, oh, I wish I was born maybe somewhere else, because there they have these incredible technology, or they have these other things, and then you forget to look back at your own place. And when I look back at Mexico, I say, this is wonderful. I'm glad that we still have this craft, and I'm glad that we have these things that I can do. And this was a low-budget project low-budget, we could fix the house, but we didn't have enough a lot of money. I could only do CNC in a very thin-gauge metal. But we had like 45 iron workers working on the project, that when we started doing the facade and putting the pieces together, it started making sense. I created a 10-centimeter width elements that with the work of the steel workers, we found out that if we had this styrofoam recovered plastic that you can inject inside the pieces and it would blow up, it would not sound hollow. So it would make the pieces super firm, super lightweight, and it was a way of understanding that if I work with them, if I didn't come as the arrogant architect who knows everything and just gives them something, I said, before, of course, we started the construction, I said, how can we make this better? And it really came through working with them that we developed this idea, and then we had the final result. This is the final result. And this is a project that has been shown a lot of times, and it has had a lot of mentions. Hector Esraue designed the furniture, who is a good friend of mine, but this also talks a lot about collaborations with not only Hector as the industrial designer, but also Nacho Cadena as a branding experience. But we could start getting a project that made sense in all the aspects. The tea room that you have there at the end. And after that, this is the new one that we designed a couple of months ago that I'll show briefly. It's not as fortunate as having a standalone house in a neighborhood as Polanco. This is inside these power centers that have many other shopping experiences. But we had a small place that you would enter and you would connect to an exterior terrace. So what we wanted to create in this small entrance was this stone element made of travertine marble that you would enter. This was the rooftop, but then you perforated through the stairway and then connected to the terrace above. Very simple way of accessing, very small, because the kitchen has to be, this is the minimum size that we could get as a kitchen, but then you have the staircase that goes to the upper floor and you have this complete terrace above. A little bit of the idea of the intention of the compression. Instead of looking at something that we wanted lightweight, we wanted something heavy, as the rooftop being something that you would kind of enter this cavern-like effect. The staircase, this was designed with Hector Esraue, which I love to work with him because he customizes every single piece for the clients. And after a couple of years, then he can have his furniture be part of his collection. But having this thing tailor-made makes a lot of sense to us. And you get these, even though it's a compressed space, you get all these nice reflections with the brass. You have this staircase that leads up to this space when you have the granite marble, the travertine marble coming down to meet you. another view from the other side of the space, and then the staircase, of course, going up. And I'm going to talk about reprogramming the program, because this is a project, again, for the department store company that we asked for. We didn't get this project. We were doing the one in Interlomas, and this one we said, can we work with you on this one? And I'll explain why. And this is the existing building in Insurgentes. This is Insurgentes and Felix Cuevas. These are two of the most crowded more crowded streets in Mexico. Super heavy traffic. You have the Metrobus passing by here. And the government was building the new metro line here. So while the government was building the new metro line, Liverpool said, why don't we extend this that was originally the plaza. It was a beautiful plaza. So when they started doing this building here, and this is the image that they had, I kind of panicked because I said, you're eating up a plaza that was beautiful in Insurgentes because it kind of made this gap. It was a silent space. And now you have this closed element. And he said, can we do something there? And the building, fortunately, sat 3 meters inside the original property line, so we could get 3 meters to the exterior. And the client, of course, sent us all these images again by these fancy stores with graphic design on their glasses or facades. And I said, come on, guys. I mean, we went through this before. We don't want to do graphic design. We want to do something more meaningful. We want to open up again the stores, because I can't remember when was the time that they enclosed themselves and said, people should not get distracted and buy, so you can't look out the windows. So it was like, let's come back to opening up again and connecting to the city and really having a conversation or a dialogue. So by opening up to the outside, we passed from something that started being a bit more graphical and converted into a 3D environment. And by a 3D environment, I said, please, let's make this a space that is not for you guys to put a Mother's Day sale or Father's Day sale. I don't want any mannequins there. What happens if we try to work and do additional program? And of course, they were curious to see what I wanted to say to them. And I said, well, I have a friend that's in the music business, and he does radio stations that are super interesting now, because you can get a digital radio station, which is not that expensive, but we can have ears now for your company. So if you have a radio station, maybe one of the hexagons, you can be doing an interview to a guy that you're selling his records up there. So it makes sense for the company, because you can sell more records if you have that. We were providing the idea of gastronomical experiences. I was presenting him to different people, and they didn't get it. They said, no, that's not my business. I don't know if I want to do that. So I brought in a company that works with brands. And I said, well, if you don't do it, hire this company. They work with brands. They know how to do this. And that way we can connect to the exterior, and it could make sense to really connect to the city. We did all these small models, of course, the drawings with experiences of bands playing and maybe some meetings, sound theaters that you would have. Here's the 3 meters that we have on the facade. And the client said, I still don't get it. No, how much is that company going to pay me to use these spaces? I said, we don't know, because this is a new model. Just let them use it for a year and let's see what happens. This is one of the guys, speaking about the facade and craft again, digital design and the local fabrication. In this project in particular, which the facade has 3 layers, it's 3 different companies, the facade is structural, so it was complex to even coordinate all these 3 things happening at the same time. And when I was sending the drawings to one of the first companies, I said, okay, here's the drawings, you can CNC cut it. And I went to the site to see how they were doing, and I said, where's your 3D, where's your machine doing all the cutting? And he said, that's my machine. And this guy cut by hand, really, literally, maybe 35 to 40 hexagons, exactly the same. Cut, welded, and sent to site, and it was like a Swiss company had just brought them in. It was beautiful. And I always say that I wish you could smell the picture, because the burn of the steel and the craftsmanship is when people say, oh, I don't get it, because your architecture doesn't look that Mexican. And I said, man, if you looked at the process, you would really know that it's super Mexican, no? 3 meter high hexagon. And we had a couple of these as well. The welding, the bending, the everything coming to place, the craftsmanship. I'm super proud, because I always say that these are the real heroes, no? And it's incredible when you actually come and acknowledge what they're doing. They're super proud and they're super happy to be part of the project. here's one of the clients when we were doing the mock-up, because normally we don't, in Mexico, it's not common that you do mock-ups. They say the client is always concerned about, if I spend money on the mock-up, why don't you put it on the facade? I said, no. Here's where you test the materials. Here's where you test the companies to see if they're going to deliver the great job. And it's funny because when he got inside and he started taking pictures, like saying, oh, now I get the space. I'm like, what are you talking about? We're going to build in a month. And you say you're only getting it now? What did you get before then, no? And it was interesting when you saw the construction, because it sits in this, as I was explaining, this super busy corner. You have all these cars, so people were watching the construction. This is now the finished project. Here you have the spaces. And sadly enough, nothing has happened to these exterior spaces. The company paid for it. At least you don't see a mannequin saying super mother sale or end of the year sale or whatever. But they're empty spaces. I mean, the store manager kept one of the hexagons and he made it his double height private office, which at least somebody's using it. But it's super sad that you only see people peeking out and then going back in, because I think this could be really activated in a very creative way. There was some kids that went to the company saying, can you rent it for a co-working space? We'll be happy to rent you the complete facade and we'll rent it out for people. No, that's too complicated, because who's going to come in and out, and we're going to have to check if they're not going to steal anything. I said, who's going to steal? They're going to work, and of course they're going to buy coffee, and maybe they'll have meetings in your department store. So it made totally total sense. And but even though it didn't happen, I asked, these are the people from my office, I asked them if they could sit down so I can take a picture, because I was so anxious that nothing happened there. I was like, please at least just let me take a picture of somebody having their breakfast or having some coffee. Now and then you see a guy having coffee maybe, but again, it's these kind of, I don't say failed opportunities, because what's interesting to me is that we managed to build it. And the other day I was giving a lecture in Phoenix, Arizona, and an architect came up to me. He said, with your project, I convinced my client to do something, and we're activating an additional space that the company was not aware of. So if this could ignite something else to happen, I'm super glad we did it. No, I'm not working with the company anymore, because they wanted to do another department store. And to me, I don't want to become, I don't want to specialize in department stores. But second, I don't want to have a client that might not want to go all the way in the things that we're doing. I don't care if he paid me and he built the project. I think it's a matter, again, of this shared responsibility of pushing all the way for a project to finish. This is another project that we just finished in Mexico, in Monterrey, close to the border in the north city of Monterrey. And one of the best or the most important things, this is the floor plan, this is a street, and then you have the other street here. The first thing that I wanted to do was open up the project towards the street. And this was done 6 years ago or 7 years ago, when Monterrey used to make fun of Mexico City, because we had a lot of insecurity issues and crime, and they were saying, oh, here in Monterrey, everything's great. And by that time, it was super worse in Monterrey. They had really tough times. And to propose a building that would open up to the street was kind of insane, because most of the people were doing these super huge base projects with the security people there. And then, of course, a tower raised, kind of a bit generic. And I said, no. I mean, we're also responsible if we kind of protect ourselves by doing these type of buildings. Because I remember a conversation with Mimi Seeger about all these insecurity issues. He said, we were talking about, if I have a pedestal with security, that only makes my government not put policemen there. Because he said, oh, the private guys are taking care of their own things, so they have their police, they'll be okay. Let's take the police and put them someplace else that they can really take care of. So I said, well, again, this is understanding whose responsibility is it. If I open up, this will be activated with people, and of course the government is going to have to take care of it in a way, because if they don't take care of it, you'll have a lot of people complaining. And I was happy and glad that my client agreed to it. This is just to show you that we do super high technological tests of the materials that we use in our office. The spinning chair to get some light in to convince the client that we wanted to do a rock facade, and crafted hand piece by piece. These are our desks at our office, and I always say that if the desk is too neat, something's wrong. They have to be all messy in order for me to make sense that they are really working, you know? And we did these units because at the time we were doing the building, it's a mixed-use building that has a base with a retail. It has some office space also, but then it has residential. And at that time, there was a lot of private houses, and the people that lived in the houses didn't want to leave because they had their gardens. So we said, why don't we give them units that they have not only terraces, but popped-in terraces, no? Where you have a threshold here, but you have a small terrace that becomes something bigger, or you have a just a popped-up terrace inside, or just a typical terrace on the outside with some gardens. Again, ideas with the rock, and this is a shot of the building, a rendering of the building, which to me, it just comes, or it makes sense to present something that you really want to build. It's not something to impress a client, or it's something to make me get a sense or get me closer to the final result. This is the building as it was being finished. And again, something that's important to me is the context. And here the context was about who's paying attention to the rock for, or the, these mountains and these rocks. They're super powerful in Monterrey and they make a lot of sense. So the movement that you see here, the play of shadow, was something that we wanted to create with the building and the motion and the terraced areas that I was talking about. The plaza being open to the exterior, some views while it was still under construction. And here you start noticing what was meant to happen, that I was saying, I don't want, if somebody's super introverted, this is not the right building. This is something that you want to share, that you want to be seen community-wise, because when you come in the building, you're seen coming in either from the car park or the public plaza. because that's also a thing to think about. I used to, my parents lived in Satélite, which is an area of Mexico City there, that the door of our house was always open. Our neighbors would come in, the kids of the neighbors would come in. Everybody knew each other. It was a neighborhood as we, most of us grew in these type of neighborhoods that were super, well, here I think you still don't always lock your doors, but in Mexico you do have to lock your doors. But I was kind of being aware of what happens now. And a lot of people that live in residential buildings, I've seen most people come in their car, and they live in a building, and they prefer to wait inside their car than to get into the elevator and meet their neighbors, just so they don't go in the elevator with somebody else. And before, if you would go on vacation, you would tell your neighbors that you would go on a vacation if they could take care of the house, and please be something strange happened that they would call. Now, you would never tell your neighbor you're leaving because you would think that maybe the neighbor would get into your apartment, no? So again, we complain about safer cities and more welcoming cities, but what are we doing? No? What are we doing as people that we live in cities? Are we welcoming our neighbors? Are we becoming friendlier or less friendlier? No, because it's funny, I don't remember where this was, but there was an experiment on people that lived in a building that people didn't know each other, but they had this chat, WhatsApp chat, and everybody was super friendly in the WhatsApp chat. Yeah, sure, let's meet for, we're gonna do these plans. But nobody knew their faces. Nobody had seen each other. They would pass each other, but they didn't know who everybody was. But yeah, Toño from apartment 501, yeah, he's suggesting that we plant these trees. So one of the guys said, guys, we have to see each other's faces. We have to come down and meet each other because this is super awkward, no? So it's funny how people now can send naked pictures through social media, but they can't see somebody eye to eye, no? But that's something to think about. So this type of building is a building that I want, that to me makes sense when it has people. There's some buildings that look super nice when they're empty and they can be photographed, but this makes a lot of sense to me once it's activated, once you see a neighbor that is looking to see what these guys are doing, or when it lights up at night and you have the people walking and they create shadows on the rooftop. And also, a building that on daytime looks black, but at nighttime it becomes this warm color because it's that wood on the ceilings. Again, a building that makes that is in a way trying to make a relation or immediacy to the context of the geography instead of these buildings that you're getting more often. Final images of the building. Falcon headquarters. Are we okay with time? I don't know if we're good. Okay. Falcon headquarters is a building that we did for a client. This is an office building. And I'll talk about collaborations here because this is a project that I did in 2003 with Derek Delecamp. Derek Delecamp is a super, not only a really close friend, but a really good architect. He's presenting a Swiss pavilion in a couple of months in Mexico City that's amazing, all made in wood. But I collaborated with him on this first project. 11 years later, they called us to do a second project, and here I invited Gabriela Chegaray, who now is the partner of Jorge Ambrosi, a young firm also doing great work. And this is also a little bit to question collaborations. Coming from the musical industry, if you would see somebody play on stage, if it was a good guitar player or a good bass player, immediately you would want to meet that guy and ask him to play, because it was super interesting to meet talented people and work with them. And as soon as I left music for architecture, I remember telling a couple of architects, oh, we should work. Yeah, sure. And I found out that nobody worked at that time. I mean, this was talking about 11, 12, or 15 years ago. And everybody thought that if you would collaborate with somebody, you were there just to steal their ideas and do them on your own. And I started pushing for collaborations. I said, well, it's incredible to share, but really collaborate. Open up your minds and collaborate and do something that you would not do on your own and do it as a collaborative process. So this is an example of two things that happened during that time in different periods. First, an existing house in San Angel that was covered by a glass called Panelite, which has these plastic straws. And then 11 years later, as I was explaining, the company grew and we decided to do a second building. Some aerial shots. Here's where I talk about optimism, no? Because here's when I came in with the client and he said, do you think we can do something interesting to my new office? And I said, yes, we can demolish it. And he said, no, but we don't have money to demolish it. We have to keep it, and we have to be really creative with the budget. So we broke almost all of the house. We kind of restructured it a little bit to create these elements that had to do with his company. It's a pharmaceutical company, so it was about the molecules and about these things happening, pixelating. It's super interesting because the windows touch on the corner. So the structure actually, you have a truss at the top of the building that makes kind of the upper teeth, and then the lower elements that have some of the columns, but they connect through steel plates on the windows. So I never get into all those details, but it's super interesting what we did on the first project. As I said, 11 years later, we get to do the second one. And this is the second project where we wanted to do something that had a dialogue with the existing one, or something that was not, again, the orange box, but maybe was something different. So it's a glass box behind these planters that also talk about the craft in Mexico. We designed the planters. They have stainless steel rods with irrigation system that water the plants. And this is the project when we finished it. It's very nice. Of course, this is what the architects normally want. Let's see how the project looks like that. Fortunately, the plants have grown incredibly, and this is a picture taken by myself. I still have to get a photographer there, but once the nature is kind of flooding on top, it makes the project much, much better. It starts kind of tying and matching and making sense, and when you see that the plants are happy, something was done right, no? There's something kind of interesting that... So again, some of the detailing of how we did the building, how you can see through the space and how people work, and the relationship of the existing building that you walk up to this other building, and then you have a bridge that connects both of them to a kitchen where the employees eat. And then you have these beautiful jacaranda trees that kind of make this beautiful relation to the existing building. And that's the bridge that connects. And I'm going to talk about a project here in Canada. We won a competition for the warming hut in Winnipeg. And you guys are aware of the warming hut, not for sure. And the government wanting people to come out and enjoy the incredible winter in Winnipeg at minus, what's the extreme temperature, 38 or 40? Super cold. Of course, for a Mexican getting there, it was like, really? I'm going to be working? Because we had to build it on site. But what we presented is something, how can we have this mix of something prefabricated and something recycled? And this is kind of, again, to question our work as architects, because we can be super neurotic, and we want to design not only 100%, we want to do 135% of a building. And so I said, what if we design part of it, and we go to the site, and we work with the carpenters there, we figure out what's the craft that they know how to do best, what do we learn from them, and what did they learn from the elements that we send prefabricated. So this is the project we presented, that of course a warming hut that you can get inside the project and just be there for a couple of minutes so that you're not the wind doesn't get into your system. So this is what we send as the digital part, a steel frame, prefabricated laminated beams. Here we were testing the lighting effect on the building and how the light could maybe start working in favor of the project. And this is what we send. We send pictures of the 3D models. We this is the type of models we do. And I have to confess that at some point in my office, it was growing so fast that we stopped doing these type of models. And I said, there's something going on that's wrong. I don't want to do physical models for the client. The physical models are for us to understand the processes that we're doing as architects to really make things happen in a better way and to make us conscious of the solutions that we're providing. So you would see these big models, the different scales. We were even sending, what if we tied these pieces of wood? And of course, a guy from Winnipeg said, if you use rope, it'll break immediately. It'll freeze and it'll break, so we cannot use rope. This was the images that we got from the site. Of course, you had to put it in a cart that was like a sledge that you would pull to the lake, so it would have to fit on this element. So I said, if we put the center here and it sprawls out, can we do that? They said, yes. This is how we got to the site when I went there. This is one of the carpenters. And I remember when the wood started coming, it arrived like that, and the guys were super worried and concerned. They said, oh, we're sorry, we couldn't get you these plank woods, that you flat ones that you send on the model that are super well worked. We only got these that have bark in it. And I said, no, this is perfect. It's not what I wanted, but this is what we have, and this is what we'll work with. So I immediately started understanding the benefit of getting something that had structure and something that would not even close as we planned on. And this is, again, what I say about being neurotic, that if I would have my older mentality, I would have been like, no, this is not going to work. It's going to ruin our project. And I said, no, let's work with what we have. It started being amazing that the applications that we had, and we started getting this light filtering through the cracks of the openings, and it worked much, much better. And there was an engineer there that also told us, if everything would have been flat, with the weight of the snow, this thing would have broken in 2 seconds. So it's really good that you have the perforations. So I'm like whew, that's good. and you started getting also the effects of the bark on the outside and the inside with these different colors. And one really great experience about this project, we had to build it with our own hands. And that came also like a shocking experience to me, because I said, when was the last time I ever built something? So it's super important now to me that I at least get to build something once a year, and I want to continue this. I wish doing these type of projects someplace else. If they don't happen, I still want to do it in my own country, because you kind of reconnect. You're working there, you reconnect to the sensation of the idea that you can sketch something, develop it, but then build it. So I think it's super important as a process to reconnect all these things that your office grows and you're this architect that just comes into the site and gives instructions and move to the client to have more meetings. And I want to come back to this, why I started doing architecture. So this is me. I remember there were like, I don't remember how many companies, and you had, of course, international press, and they wanted to talk to these architects that came from abroad. And they were calling me like, you have to come down for the interviews. And I said, no way I'm getting down. I want to finish. I was really obsessed on finishing because it really felt so good. Every nail that I was getting in there, I was bleeding from my hands. And I was sending pictures to my daughter. She was like, Daddy, but you're bleeding. I said, but I'm having fun. This is what happens also in marathons. We have a sense of masochistic pleasures. it was super. I had never handled a power gun. In Mexico, you don't get to use that many. But it was super interesting. And these were my best critics. I loved when kids came along, because kids came along and they started expressing themselves in a great way. Adults, on the other hand, they saw this thing and they were like moving around. Where's the door? And if there was no door, they would not go in. And this is also something to think about. We get really boring when we grow old. We're expecting people to tell us what to do, and we're looking for all these signals and signs. Kids would just come in, duck their heads, get in the space, and wow, this is fun. And adults will just walk away and go out. I would have to tell people, no, you can get in, really. There is no door, but here you pass. It's okay. Well, watch your head. But it was super interesting. It was fun to do the project. And I'll end with this last one, which we're doing now, which is another cultural project. I said I remember saying, and I ate my words, because I said I would not work for the government again. After the experience of the Cineteca, that's not finished. But I was tempted by this competition for a symphony hall, and we won this project. It was a competition for an existing orchestra that is from Boca del Río in Veracruz. And they do these incredible programs. They pick up kids from the streets. They give them instruments. They start working with them. So they have this whole influence by Venezuela that started doing all these programs as a social activation thing. But they have a great orchestra led by Mester, the director. And they didn't have a house. So normally, people first design a place for musicians to start coming out being super talented. They're already talented, they're already touring, but they didn't have a place. So there was a competition that we won, and they decided to do it here in the beach, in this area that is kind of a desolated area. And again, the first thing, even though it was the government, this is the image of the project that we won with. So it's a concrete shell building that sits in one of the areas that you're hit by the north winds super bad. So we created something that would break a little bit the winds coming from the north, and it opens up to this wave breaker that you have originally there. Boca del Río is named Boca del Río because this is the river that goes directly to the sea. So we're sitting exactly in the point of where it's called Boca del Río. And again, pushing the idea of added value, I sat down with a politician in charge at the moment, which is my client, Miguel Angel Yunes, and I told him, we're doing the symphony hall here, but you can do a whole master plan and you can question what the impact of the cultural building here is going to do. Because if you present it as a standalone thing, again, you're not being responsible of understanding what is the possibilities that could happen around the space. And I don't come in saying it in an arrogant way to my client. I come in with a sociologist, and I come with a financial guy behind us, and I come in with people that make him aware of the opportunity. So here is part of the government, the Zócalo, this street, this whole element that's 1.5 kilometers, the wavebreaker that already existed there, but if you walked on it, you would find diapers, beers, all these awful things that normally happen in not well taken care areas. So we said, why don't we provide this element that can have mainly be for pedestrian use? Why don't we create these two additional streets? Because if you have this street that exists already and connect from the back, you can reactivate this whole area. What if you change the zoning? Because now it's not really taking advantage of. What if we do two or three story pedestal buildings that connect with all these restaurants and coffee shops to the exterior and connect to the beach, but then recess back, do 20 levels, but a recessed building that kind of just comes back but has the view and can create a better space. What do we do public elements here that have the bathrooms and create other areas for the lifeguards and people to reactivate the area? So he agreed with the ideas. This is what sits inside the symphony hall. It works for 850 people. It has the back of the house, the rehearsal rooms. It has additional spaces for projections if people don't fit completely in the space. They have additional space in the back, a section of the project. Some images, how you enter through this, the wave breaker. Thinking of the exterior and the finishes, it's a concrete, these concrete boxes that we wanted them to have this texture, again, talking about the Mexican craftsmanship. So we're creating this texture that it starts reflecting time, and it's okay that it starts becoming this concrete that works with the patina of the place. Of course, the wee bars are galvanized wee bars for the foundation. The upper part are regular wee bars. But here's how it sits on the site. It's already being under construction. And this is what you had on the existing site. So you had abandoned lots. You had things that started construction, but nothing happened. And now that the project started, all these plots, they're starting to become something different that hopefully, here you have a larger building, they start developing. There's a client that will start soon a project here after we started the project for the Symphony Hall. This is how it sits today. It's been going slower than the original intent. Here's where you would access. This is the lobby. Here we will come up to the mezzanine and connect to the upper area. And it was expected to be finished in November, but they're going to finish it maybe in a couple, by mid or the end of next year. It's going slow, but as long as they finish it, as I always say. Some of you. And I will just close with saying this, that if we design spaces for other things to happen, they will. They will be used and occupied in ways where we can learn to understand the future life of buildings. And that is the biggest challenge of architecture. Because before we could predict a little bit how society was changing. We could plan buildings, yes, it will take 6 years to build, but yeah, society is not changing that fast. It was super predictable. Now it's not predictable. Now we're chasing society, how society is interacting and evolving, and it's super important to understand that architecture has to have at least some of the parts that you're seeing what's happening, that they can have this flexibility to be aware of the future life of buildings. So now I can say thank you. Thank you very much.
So what do you think? Can we take a few more minutes to get some questions in here, some comments? Are you okay with that?
Yeah, of course.
If somebody wants to ask something. Come on. Or after the marathon now.
Anybody? Please, up here and then Gail.
Just more of a comment. It looks like the weather is to your advantage there, where we have a lot more variances between our temperatures in the spring or summer and winter. So I can see how it's such a huge advantage to having more of a stable climate for design, especially outdoors.
Oh, for sure. Just, I'll answer that yes, of course. But it's funny because most of the times I get like, oh, what you do is easy because you live in Mexico. You don't have all these things that are difficult in the places that we do. I think every place has its own challenges, no? I don't know if you remember once we were shortlisted for the tower in Mississauga. We were working with Arup on this exoskeleton thing called the Earthmark Tower. And of course We wanted, first of all, to have something that was a windbreaker. So we designed this exoskeleton to become a windbreaker for the complete tower in itself. And then, of course, we had all these exterior terraces, and I was getting people saying, oh, exterior terraces, you can't pour the concrete completely to the outside, you have to break it because of temperature. So we started learning about what were the difficulties. And I always use Herzog and Dameron as an example, no? Because if they did the Lincoln Park, the 111 Park car park in Miami, that they would say, no, the United States has almost the worst regulations. They got away with so many things because they were clever enough to present it and argue them in a good way. Say, well, you want these requirements? Let's try this and let's see if it passes. So I just think it's a matter of being curious enough, stubborn enough to push things as far as you can. So if I would live here, I would still be pushing stuff, no? Not only because I live in Mexico, but, and I don't know.
No, I agree. I completely agree. The fact of also having a more constant weather in Mexico City, or at least around, it's also or could be a difficult thing to control. Let's say over here you have always like two glass windows and isolated interior environment versus exterior high temperature contrasts. And in Mexico you always get this kind of a homogeneous climate change that doesn't look so much, but at the end you have to be very intelligent, smart to understand how the winds go. And to solve isolation without this costly thermal system you have here, for example.
Hi, Michelle, how are you?
Good.
Good.
Nice to see you.
At one point in your career as an architect, did you decide that you wanted to be different, you wanted to do different, you wanted to step out of the box? What were your influences?
I would have to ask my mom now. I've always been a bit hyperactive. In fact, one of the research areas of my office is called ADD, because I call it advanced development. What was it? Deficit de atención, advanced diagnostic design. Yeah, I know I can't remember, sorry for the advanced diagnostic design. And I was making fun of that because at some point I was diagnosed, but my mother paid it. She said, I'm not going to medicate you. I don't know if it was for better or for worse. But I've always been, if I was leaving music for architecture, I really wanted to push stuff. Otherwise I would still be drumming in a band, no? I said, if I'm going to leave architecture, music, and be an architect, I really want to explore what I see in Mexico, this creativity that, as I was saying, is because of necessity, no? Because it's a survival mode thing. And I said, this is incredible, because what happens, all the informality that takes over the city and disappears, is to me is incredible. It's like magic, no? It's like something happens, and not only in Mexico, in most of the places where the system doesn't work as a system. So seeing that is like, how can I do stuff that's a bit more traditional? If this thing kind of, there's interesting things happening going on all the time. Maybe if I lived in some other place in Mexico that was a bit calmer, I would be doing something different. But living in Mexico City, which is, there's always a problem. It's super chaotic. My daughter's 11 years old now, but when I started having all these conversations, I said, in Mexico, when you get off the sidewalk, you have to look up, down, around, left, right, because somebody can be falling from a building. So it doesn't matter if the green light is there. Look everywhere, no? And that's a little bit of this kind of awareness. And it's not as, I mean, Chris was talking about relationships with music. In my mind, it's not literally the aspects of motion, repetition, and stuff that I had in my music. It's about this cross-pollination of ideas that I figured out, or I, to myself, that the worst thing I could ever do is only see things as an architect. If I only saw things as the architect, I was missing a lot of the information. So I kind of then say, okay, what would the person living the city do? Not the architect, the guy who lives in a city and wants a city to change. And what would a musician do? And what would the father of an 11-year-old daughter do? So I kind of think of all the different, I'm not gonna say the different people inside your head, because that's gonna make me look like, I swear I don't have multiple personalities. But you have to, or you engage conversations with all the collaborators. With Tonio, we've been collaborating for years, and it's amazing to have people like Antonio on projects, because you have different perspectives, but you have to be open to collaborations. Because there's a lot of people that say, I collaborate, this is my idea, do it. That's not a collaboration, that's an imposition of your idea because you don't know how to collaborate. No? And it's been fun because even at the beginning where I would never have a lawyer in a meeting, I said the least person that you want to have in a meeting is a lawyer. But now, if you have a creative lawyer that is in a meeting with you and makes a client understand that the policies are changing and this will happen in the future, so he puts in something that became essential for the project, he's welcome anytime. No? So the meetings get bigger, that at the beginning, clients did not even pay for them. They were like, oh, can you please collaborate on a project with us? Because we want to make the client understand. And now the clients are paying for that because it becomes a business strategy that makes his business, first of all, better, but it makes better projects for the city and for us. And if I don't feel comfortable with what I'm designing, I will not do it. I'd rather not do it. I'd rather come back to drumming. But sorry, I extended a little bit. Other question?
Thank you very much, Michelle, for a really, really great presentation. And I'm really curious. I mean, I'm going to ask this question because I think I see you very sort of a little bit introspective on sort of your career and how it's evolved. How have you changed, or your ideas changed, or your approach to a project changed from your early years to where you are now? Where would you like to take this?
When I talk about responsibility, it doesn't. I'm not talking about being serious. No, I'm talking about, I mean, serious enough to be responsible, but in that sense, still be playful. No? So I think it's a careful play of words, because when we say responsible, it's like, okay, now you're super serious. No. I mean, we have to be responsible. I sometimes we're doing work now that I didn't know we would be doing, no? I mean, these business strategies of preparing a facade that could be inhabited by a different program, you wouldn't think that was design. You would just be worried about the details of the facade, and you would then give it to the client that you wouldn't care. Now sometimes it's more interesting to design that strategy than even designing something physical. So designing an outdoor cinema for the Cineteca that was not asked for, no? All these elements that you're designing that, again, don't have to do with anything physical, but are really ideas that make sense to you because it connects to the city. So I want to keep on doing things that feel right, no? That are that makes more sense. And especially I think that when you have kids, you question more of the stuff. I have an incredible daughter, which she has been an incredible teacher over time. And she comes up with these ideas and things that I'm blown away. No, I mean, at some point I remember, she's now 11, but she was like, when she was 6 or 7, I'm divorced, but I'm best friends to her mom. And she came to my house and she said, "Dad, you adults are super funny because you have plants that are just decorative." I said, "What do you mean?" "Yeah, you have plants that are there, but they don't do anything. So you don't have, I mean, you're not planting stuff that you have a relationship with them, that they give you stuff, and then you're more aware and you take care of them, and then you take some chilies or you take some lime." And I was looking at her like, wow, we must be, I hope we're the last, sorry, fucked up generation, and that the new generation that is coming is more aware of different things. But you do, it makes you more aware. Even the things that I was talking about being getting boring as an adult, my daughter's always getting me with that. If I am too concerned about work, she's like, "Dad, you're growing old now. You have to come back. Be a kid again, no? Don't take things so seriously." So I'm happy to say that now we're getting more clients that understand that, even though sometimes they don't push it to the, or finish, go all the way. But at least we're getting clients that come in and ask us, "What are we gonna do? What can you do with our company?" I say, "Well, I mean, I could do something that you want to go there, but I cannot force you in any direction, no?" But I hope that it again, if we design things that give something back, as little as it may be, imagine if most of the projects did the same thing. We would have better cities, no? And it's, I think that would change it a little bit at least. But yeah. Even this, sorry, just as an extent, even having Chris over, as I was saying, why in music do bands have opening acts, which is beautiful, no? Because you come see a band, yeah, but they have somebody that you might not have listened to. So this is also kind of an interesting thing that I wish happened more, no? That you were kind of introduced to more people. And I think that's also happening with newer generations, that they're more collaborative, no? This open source thing. I also want to think that we were kind of the last generation to be less collaborative. And now even kids, they don't call their offices Office for Architecture, they're collaboration
think tanks,
yeah. And I mean, when I was a musician, it was people didn't take me seriously because you had something else doing in your life. And now an architect is slash blogger, photographer, fashion critic, food critic, and it's more common. You're not so concerned that they do many things. It's kind of how they move, no, and how they feed their mind. But I think we're done.
So I'll ask you one question, and then I think we might wrap up. But you spent the day today walking. You both did. Walking around Toronto, what did you see?
So a lot of lake, a lot of the lake, and a very interesting contrast in architecture and how the people are moving around. I mean, I was impressed by the amount of people cycling, and you get to see this amazing cultural of cycling people. I arrived today, so I saw this tiny rear mirror on the side of the cab, which is a system like tells you to be careful when you open the door for the bikers. So I think it was really interesting, and it really reflects like the culture of the city, of this change of trying to implement new ways of commuting. And I think that was very grateful and interested for me.
Thanks. First of all, I have to say that I don't have to be here actually in Toronto, because being a good friend with Antonio and the way he talks and brags in a beautiful way about the public realm and the life on the streets, just following his Instagram is a good example to have kind of the feel on what's going on. But I'm always impressed. I'm always impressed not only about the activation on the pedestrian realm. Well, I have to also say I was impressed this time here in Toronto of how your skyline has changed. You have so many huge buildings, and we were talking about this, because a lot of generic buildings that I hope you get a lot of interesting ones as well. Not that it's bad, but you're filling up the skyline with many common things that I think some of them are missing, kind of the authenticity and what I see on the public realm and the people on the streets. But I think it's beautifully activated, not only because you have more bikes, but also because there's culture, there's many things happening. I've only been here 2 days, and happy to spend more time. Especially, one of the best things about running is that you get a sense of scale of cities that you normally don't get when you're in a car. I've been carless for 6 years now in Mexico City. As soon as we got the bike sharing system, I decided that I would sell my car. And biking, of course, is another skill, which is great, but running just provides something that is kind of magical, no? Because you're stomping your feet on the floor like a kind of mantra meditation thing, but you're watching the city. So I'm really looking forward to running 42, I'm not going to think about it too much, but running a full marathon and coming to the finish line. But congratulations on the perfect. I think it's a really good mix on taking everybody's point of view and trying to make it happen really on the streets.
So I'll have a question for everybody in the audience, though. Who has planned Sunday morning? One hand has planned. So I expect everybody else. Michelle has already confessed that kilometer 37 is the wall. So needs special support, cheering, and a little bit of...
From 30 to 30-something, yeah.
A little bit of...
If there's some architects there.
Happening around kilometer 30 to 37. So thereabouts. But please join me in a round of applause and thanking both Chris and Michelle. Thank you very much. And I'm sure they'll linger a little bit if you want to come up and chat with them.